John chapter 4. Let's stand up and so I can read the Word of God. Let's be respectful of God's Word.
Amen.
John chapter 4. And the Bible says in verse number 31, "In the meanwhile, his disciples prayed him, saying, Master, eat. But he said unto them, I have meat to eat that ye know not of. Therefore said the disciples one to another, Hath any man brought him aught to eat? Jesus saith unto them, My meat is to do the will of him that sent me, and to finish his work. Say not ye, There are yet 4 months, and then cometh harvest. Behold, I say unto you, Lift up your eyes and look on the fields, for they are white already to harvest. And he that reapeth receiveth wages, and gathereth fruit unto life eternal, that both he that soweth and he that reapeth may rejoice together. And herein is that saying true, One soweth and another reapeth. I sent you to reap whereon ye bestowed no labor. Other men labored, and ye are entered into their labors." Father, thank you for the message today, Lord God. And thank you for the people showing up today, Lord God, to hear the Word of God. Hear it from you, Lord Father. Put me aside and talk to the people, Lord Father. And let's get some fresh oil today, Lord God. Let it be something we've never heard before that speaks directly to us. I want to hear from you, Lord. I want to hear directly. I want to get my life to change, Lord Father. And I want you to work with me, to work in me today, Lord. I want to be changed. Lord Father, just ask you if one needs you today, that you'd be attentive to that person, Lord God, that you would move throughout the room and sup with that person today, speaking to them, Lord Father, in a very special way. Father, I thank you for the people that are here again today. I know they have prayer requests. I pray for Brother Halil's wife, Lord Father, for protection for her, Lord Father, and also, Lord, a merciful journey that she had, traveling mercies to get here, Lord Father, and when she comes, Lord, I pray, Lord, that it would be a joyful day when she comes, that we can sit down and actually sup with her too, Lord Father. And also, Lord, for Steve Allen, Matthew's father, Lord, I pray, Lord God, you help him as he's in the hospital, Lord Father, and bring him out smoothly, Lord. And again, Lord, I can't wait to have him sit down with us here. Become one of us, Lord, just like us, one-minded, and we thank you for it. Lord, talk to our hearts today in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen, amen, amen. Now, you'll notice the first words in there, it said, in the meanwhile. In the meanwhile. Okay, so that means as something was going on, this was happening. Okay, so what was going on? Well, that brings us back to last week. What was going on? Okay, so go up, and verse number, it says in verse number, back up in verse 26, Jesus saith unto her, I that speak unto thee am he. He's talking about the Christ, the Messiah, that she said in verse 25. And then you'll notice the disciples came up, but they didn't say anything. And look what it says in verse number 28. And it says, and the woman then left her water pot and went her way into the city and saith to the men, come, see a man which told me all things that I ever did. Is not this the Christ? Now, didn't he just tell her he was the Christ?
Amen.
And she still asked, isn't this the Christ? But she's at least she's at a public witness right now talking about what she just heard. Okay? She's a public witness. Hey, come see a man. You got to see this man. Told me everything. Is he not the Christ? This is the Christ. I found the Christ. Now it says, verse number 30, it says, then they,
those men. Then they went out of the city and came unto him. So this is happening while people are coming out. And I want you to understand another thing. We keep thinking very eventful because we're impatient. This lasted 2 days. It lasted 2 days. It took some time. Why? Go over to verse number 43. Now after 2 days, he departed thence and went into Galilee. 2 days. So they all were coming out in that time. In the meanwhile, this is all, something is going to go on. Those verses that I just spoke unto you are going to happen in the meanwhile as these people started coming out to see Jesus Christ. I mean, imagine the life of Christ that way. I mean, we read the scriptures, but we've been trained sometimes to read the scriptures and we don't get the right, what we see is not always the same as how the Bible puts it. Because other men have come along and they preach this. I mean, let's face it. When Jesus Christ got into a room, I mean, in Mark chapter 2, he gets there and they said they couldn't, nobody could get in. For the press, I mean, things are happening around him. A guy walks around and people are getting healed. A guy walks around and he touches somebody, they all of a sudden, they're whole. Somebody touched his garment, they're whole. You think you're going to hide that man? When he came over across the sea of Galilee, he gets on the other side. They start bringing stretchers down there to meet him. This guy, there's something different about this man. He couldn't hold it back. Now, he comes out there to that woman that's right there, the woman at the well, they called her. He comes out there, and guess what? Things start to go on. You need to come down here. You need to see this man, is what they were saying. You need to see this man who told me everything. Is he not the Christ? And then he turns around. The disciples had come up to him. It said they came up to him. They didn't say anything. They held their peace. Usually they all got involved. What's he talking to her for? She's not the right one. Why is he talking to them? Why is he talking to that Samaritan? See, you don't think people think like that? Why is the pastor talking to that person? Well, why isn't he talking to me? I've been in his church for 5 years, and he's talking to that guy over there. And he's only been here for 4 months. And you know, I saw that guy at the bar last week. We think like that. I've been trying to live righteous. Why isn't he talking to me all the time? Why doesn't he do these things? Look, you're already in the master's house. You realize that? Those other people, they need to get in. They need that blessing sometimes. And God directs those things. You see, that's why, remember that kid, the prodigal son? He goes off and things happen to him, and then his brother is his brother's kind of left behind, and he gets he gets all crazy about some stuff. And doesn't even realize that he had it so well. What was the one kid wanting to do? Come back home. Why? The goodness is in the father's house. He's already in. You got to enjoy it while you're here. You got to enjoy those things. Hey, look, you know yourself. You're here. Most of you people are here at least 2 times a week. Some of you are here every time the door opens. Man, you're at the master's table. The Lord's getting that word opening, and you're getting so much. That's the greatest privilege there is, to hear the word of God.
Amen.
You know, the greatest privilege is that you have a book in front of you that you can go to, and God can talk to you through that book. And you do. You know, you got more than most people would ever think of is by having that book. And being able to talk to the Lord, or hear what the Lord has to say. I post once in a while. I say, you know, you see people, they pray. And they never think about this. They pray, but they're not reading their Bible. Well, it's kind of worthless. God speaks through what? Through the Word of God. And they're not reading their Bible, but they're setting up a grocery list. Well, your prayers are about worthless. Why? God ain't speaking to you. If you ain't reading your Bible, God don't speak to you. It makes you think when people say, well, I don't need this, and I don't need, you know, I don't need to go to church all the time. I don't need this, and I don't need that, and I don't think we should be doing. You know what that person's doing? They're making an excuse up because God told them straight out what? They need to get it right. That's exactly what it is. You put the Bible up against a wall, I always tell you, it's like a mirror. What does it do? It shows you you. And you realize, I'm a pretty dastardly character. I've seen myself in that Bible so many times. The Lord turned around and told me so many times. You know what the Lord told me so many times? You're a murdering man. You're a fornicator. You're an adulterer. You're this, you're that. Why? Well, that's what that book is against me. But God talked to me. And God tells me those things. You know, and I have to deal with those things just like anybody else. So he says in here, he says, now in the meanwhile, his disciples prayed him in verse number 31, saying, Master, eat. And Jesus says, but he said unto them, I have meat to eat that ye know not of. I got to tell you this. This is what I caught on this. You're gonna realize it right here. This is a cookie I'm going to give you. I'm going to give you a cookie today that you never read it like this. Okay? The disciples are coming up. And they're worried about what? Their bellies, of course. Hey, when's the next meal? Come on. They're probably pre-Baptist stage. You know, wanting a meal every time, you know, the doors are opened up or something like that. And they get over to Christ, and Christ turns around and he says to them, I got meat. They say, I have meat to eat that ye know not of. Therefore, they turn around, the first thing they think of is, hath any man brought him aught to eat? Did he eat earlier or something? Okay, now watch this. Jesus says, now watch. And Jesus saith unto them, my meat is to do the will of him that sent me, and to finish his work. Now, you read it differently than I read it. I'll tell you how I read it. Boy, is he excited. He just won a soul. It's a chapter we're reading. What had just happened is he sat with this lady. And he turns around and he says to her, I'm the Christ. And what does she do? She runs out there and she sure starts to mix it up, telling people on the street and everything else. And she's all happy that she just got saved. Okay? She just met the Christ. She met the one of all things. She just met him here. And she's pretty excited about it. And the disciples come back, and what's the first thing they're worried about? Is their belly. And what is he doing? He's all excited. You know what he's all excited about? Man, I just want a soul. That's an exciting thing. Amen. You know, I always say it like this. I always say, you know, soul winning is one of the greatest things. And I'll tell you why. It's one thing that I think it should get addicting. Amen. It's something that should get addicting. You can't, look, once you win a soul, you know what happens at that moment? Nothing can change as far as they're saved. It's over as far as that. They can't get saved again. They're saved. Do you realize that you just changed the destiny of somebody's eternal life? Now, I'm not saying that you did it or whatever. You know, God uses us all and stuff like that. But look, Jesus is right here, and he is he's pretty excited about this, Jesus Christ. I mean, he's sitting there like, oh, man, you should see what's going on here. He turns around. He's like, he says, my meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish the work. I just want a soul. Did you see that woman that just went by? She got saved. See, that's the way I think that's the way he said it. He was excited. You've got to realize the disciples are coming up and they're thinking big shot all the time. Hey, who's going to sit on his right hand? Who's going to sit on his left hand? And there's Jesus dealing with a woman who's not even one of the Jews. He's excited. Why? Somebody just got led to Christ. Didn't he say to her, I'm he? And she took it even further. Check this out. She takes it even further and runs into the town and becomes a public witness.
That's right, you're not.
And she starts, look, when people say women can't serve God, she sure did. She even left the water pot there and ran down the way and said, hey, come see this guy. And in the meanwhile, here comes the disciples up and they're not even thinking that way. They're not even thinking to the things that he's talking about. I mean, they're thinking, oh man, what's he talking to her for? Who's she? And there's Jesus like, man, did you guys just see what just happened? Did you guys notice what had happened just here? What's that? I just want a soul. And he's excited about it to that point. I mean, he just won a soul for the Lord, and he's excited. I mean, do you get that excited when something like that happens? Is that what you do? Do you get that excited? The Lord does. I mean, I want you to know something. The Lord is pretty excited. You know, the Bible only records, as far as recording, it only records one time in that Bible that says Jesus rejoiced. Did you ever see that in the Bible? I understand it could have been rejoiced in other places, but the Bible only records it straight out. One time in Luke chapter 10, it says that he rejoiced that the babes got the word and all those educated people didn't. It says one time, records one time, and Jesus rejoiced.
Amen.
But here he is. Here's the Lord, and he gets out there, and he starts talking to this woman, and she gets it. And he turns around, and the first thing he wants to do is he wants to be happy, of course, and he wants to tell people about it, and he starts to tell them. He says, look, you guys are so worried about eating, you don't realize I just want a soul over there. And you guys need to get to work, basically, is what he's saying to them. You guys need to do this. You guys need to get to work doing this stuff. This is the greatest thing there could be, is doing this. Look down at verse number 35. He says, say ye not, there are yet 4 months, and then cometh the harvest. Behold, I say unto you, lift up your eyes and look in the fields. Why? For they are white, all ready to harvest. You think just because we're down here in Samaria, you think just because we're over here with these people that there isn't souls that can be won? Let me tell you something. Just because you're in North Philly or you're in the ghetto or you're down in Watertown or you're down in Syracuse in the bad area, you don't think you can get somebody saved? You don't think you need to witness there? Let me tell you something. As long as there's people, there's a harvest that's white.
Amen.
There's a harvest that's white. You want to see the people who really get discouraged? You want to be discouraged and think that, why don't you go over to Israel? I know missionaries over there, they'll go months upon months without being seeing a convert or seeing somebody get saved. They're not even allowed to witness. They'll throw them out of the country. Here you got people go right out and preach on the street. In other countries, you can't even do that. And it's something we should be getting involved in. You know, we should be getting involved in that stuff. He says, why don't you just look out there? Why don't you just look out there and see that these fields out there, they're just white. They're just white out there. He says, my meat is to do the will of the Father, which brings up something. He's talking about spiritual meat, isn't he? You see, the first thing that happens is religion gets in and they start talking about physical meat. John chapter 6. If you go over, they'll start talking like, oh, Jesus said, eat my flesh and drink my blood. And he's talking about something spiritual. He's talking about the will of the Father. Didn't it just say that's his meat?
Yep.
Is the will of the Father. That's what he's talking about. These words are spirit and these words are life. You know, God has everything figured out when it comes to that. He says, he turns around, he says, lift up your eyes and look out there. Yeah, you're in Samaria, but guess what? They need salvation too. They need salvation too. Not every missionary can go to Jerusalem. What about Zimbabwe? But what about Malaysia? What about all those countries you can't even pronounce? Don't you think they need it? Do you know that down in the Caribbean area, there was a group of guys who they couldn't get in. They couldn't get into the Caribbean area because the owners there, down there in those colonial type areas, they didn't want anybody in those areas. So you know what they did? They sold themselves into slavery. Imagine doing that. These guys were guys that had money. One of them was a doctor. He could have lived very well on his own. And he could have slept very well in his life. So what he does is he sells himself into slavery. I'm going to go be a slave. And he goes in amongst the slaves down in the Caribbean. He not only ministers to them as far as being a doctor, he also starts preaching to them. That whole island, in the end, basically at that time, got converted.
Amen.
Over a guy who was willing to sell himself, and not worry about himself, but sell himself into slavery for a people because he got what that says. Don't look at the fields are white. Out there. People are walking around. They're white. That's what he's talking about. Jesus is excited. I just want a soul. Hey, he could have turned around and as the king of the universe put everybody in and just made them believe. But he gets no love and glory if he was to make something happen. He gets it when somebody chooses to do it. That's how God gets glory, is when you choose it. So, look down at verse number 36, and he explains it to him. He says, and he that reapeth receiveth wages, and gathereth fruit unto life eternal. Amen. Now watch what it says. That both he that soweth and he that reapeth may do what?
Rejoice
together. You know what that's a picture of? You remember in 1 Corinthians chapter 3. In verse number 8, when we were over there, it said, one said he was Apollos, and one said he was of Christ, one said he was of Paul. And he turns around, he starts to talk about it, and he says, one watereth, and one soweth, one watereth. He says, I sowed the seed, Apollos watereth, and then it says something else. It says, but God gave the increase. You see, we're not, you've got to understand something. God never commanded you to get people saved. He commanded you to preach the gospel, to witness to people, to fill up the water pots. He didn't tell you to do the saving of it. You know what? He's telling them, you're reaping. Look down there, he says in verse number 37, he says, and herein is that saying true. Right here is that saying true, he says. One soweth and another reapeth. You know what Jesus is saying right there? I'm not the one that sowed. Do you understand what he's saying? Didn't he just say, right here, he says, one was sowing and I came and I reaped that. And then he turns around, look at the next verse. He says, I sent you to reap that whereon ye bestowed no labor. Other men labored. And ye are entered into their labors. You know who labored? All the prophets labored. The prophets. Hey, we remember Isaiah chapter 53. Remember he turns around in Isaiah 53. He says, who hath believed their report? And he starts talking about the Holy One. He said, he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes are we healed. They were talking about who? The Lamb. How about, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And all that down the line. Those prophets, they talked about these things. Hey, I'll show you where they said it way back. Because maybe this woman is way back there. Well, we'll go back there. What about back there in Genesis chapter 3? Hey, a Redeemer's coming. A Redeemer's coming. Before the flood. Do you know in every basically in about every language that's out there, they have some type of caricature about some Redeemer coming. I think in Lima, Peru, the Mayans, I think they had Quechua, a white guy that was coming. That's how Cortez jumped on that. And, the conquistador types that came in, they jumped on all that thing knowing that, and they said, here we are, we're on white horses. We're on horses. You see? They all knew that a Redeemer was coming. And then go to Deuteronomy. Go to Deuteronomy chapter 18. And it's this just this easy. God sets this up so you'll know. Go to verse number 18. Deuteronomy 18. Look at verse number 18. He says, I will raise them up a prophet from among their brethren, like unto thee, and will put my words in his mouth, and he shall speak unto them all that I shall command him. And it shall come to pass that whosoever will not hearken unto my words, which he shall speak in my name, I will require it of him. But the prophet which shall presume to speak a word in my name, which I have not commanded him to speak, or that shall speak in the name of other gods, even that prophet shall die. He says there's a prophet that's coming. Go to John. Go back in John and go to chapter 1. When John the Baptist gets out there, they start asking questions. That's what Jewish people about. They're like accountants, man. All of a sudden, John starts getting out there and preaching. They want to know by what authority he's saying. They wanted to know, why are you talking like this? And they ask him, look at verse number 21. It says, and they asked him, what then? Art thou Elias? Are you Elijah? And he saith, I am not. Now look at the next part. Art thou what?
That prophet.
Are you that prophet? What prophet? Deuteronomy chapter 18, verse 18. Are you that prophet? They knew some scripture. Hey, look, that woman knew some scripture. How? Because she turns around and she says, when Messiah comes, he'll make everything right. And he says, I'm he. She knew there was a Messiah. She knew about it. She knew some Old Testament. She knew that the worshipers up on the mountains, and they're down in Jerusalem. She knew some of it. But now all of a sudden he turns around. He says, I sent you to reap whereon ye bestowed no labor. The prophets did it. Hey, you know what? Even myself, I reaped in some of Pastor Taylor, who was up the road. I reaped in when he was done and it was gone out of here. I reaped in some of his people. And some of those people, their grandkids, I've reaped in. Why? I didn't put no labor into what he did. I came into his laboring. And somebody will come in here someday, maybe after me if the Lord tarries, and he'll reap where I've plowed and I've labored. And where you plowed, somebody will reap upon that. He says, it doesn't matter who's sowing and who's watering. It's about God that gets the increase.
Amen.
You know, he says, just because, you know, sometimes I get a lot discomfort, and I think, wow, you know, I've been out in these areas, knocking these doors and doing this and putting things out and telling people, standing on corners and with signs up, waving Bibles, trying to do a little preaching, maybe singing on the street to tell them about it. And you know what? I get frustrated. I've knocked on doors. Why ain't they coming in?
Oh, well, maybe somebody will come along after me and just bring them on in. I don't know. And the same thing happens in your families. You just don't realize it.
And in the meanwhile, as he spoke to them, in what? As these other people were coming out to see him, he starts telling them. He's excited, and he starts telling about the incident. And they don't get it. They're talking about food. And he says, you don't get it. This is a spiritual thing. I just led a soul to Christ. Now, if Jesus can get excited, why can't you?
Amen.
Why can't you get that excited when somebody gets led to Christ? I do. I don't know how many times. I mean, when Chandler got saved, we were dancing around in our house.
Amen.
She got it. We would try to every day. And then all of a sudden, she just gets up and she says, I get it. Amen. Led her to Christ right there. She's special needs. That's why it was really important. You know, it's something to rejoice about. When Mark got saved, right out here in that area right there, after he gets saved, I'm acting like an idiot. He probably looking over and going, is that what I'm going to be next? I was excited. Why? He ain't going to hell.
Amen.
Now look what it says after this. It says, and look at verse number 39. He starts, he says, and many of the Samaritans of that city believed on him for the saying of the woman, which testified, he told me all that I ever did. So many of them just believed that when she came out and told them about it. They just believed. Then look what it says. So it says, so when the Samaritans were come unto him, they besought him that he would tarry with them, and he abode 2 days. So they kept coming. And many more believed because of his own word, and said unto the woman, now we believe not because of thy saying, for we have heard him ourselves, and know that this is indeed the Christ, the Savior of what?
The world.
The world. You see, some people, you'll start to talk to them about it, and they say, hey, I want to get down there myself. I want to get down there myself, and I want to see it. I want to see what's going on. And you know what happens at that point? The Bible gets opened up. Because Jesus said, search the Scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life, for they are such that speak of him. Some people need to get into the Bible. Some people need discernment. You see? See, some of the people that came in, they said, not just because she told us, but because now we heard the Word of God and we believe. You know, usually when I deal with, when dealing with people, and this is just an observation, okay? My biggest observation is this, that I've noticed. Some people I witness to, they don't get saved. They're not getting saved. And then all of a sudden I turn around and I realize something. And I open the book up and I say, why don't you read it yourself? And they sit there and they look at the book and they see it. It says right there in Romans, you know, Romans chapter 10, and I'm holding it like this, and I go, okay, but what does it say right there? And they turn around and they say, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thine heart out of God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Usually I'm saying it right with them as they're reading it. For with the heart a man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. You see? They start reading it for themselves. Usually what I find out, if they'll take the book and they'll read it themselves, it's like the chances go, choo-choo-choo-choo-choo-choo. Why? Because now they got the Word of God themselves talking to them.
Amen.
Faith cometh by
hearing,
and hearing by. Even though I'm telling them and I'm giving Scripture and at the door or something like that, sometimes they just don't want to
They don't hear it, but boy, oh boy, when they see it themselves, sometimes they change. Mm-hmm. Why? Because not only did we hear her testimony, but now we have read it for ourselves. Jesus is excited at hearing. He wants to tell them. And they come up and they don't want to hear that somebody got saved. They want to hear, let's go eat. And he's sitting there saying, no, no, no. That food, that doesn't do anything, man. I just had somebody get saved. I changed it forever. And they got spiritual meat. And you just don't understand what's going on. You know what was going on right here? Jesus Christ is reaping on what she sowed. She runs into town and she starts telling everybody and they start coming out and he gets to preach to them again. If he was excited just over the woman, how do you think how excited he was when they all started coming out of the town?
Amen.
To come see him. Why? He spent 2 days with them after that, the Bible says. He spent 2 days. What did he have? He had a revival meeting.
Amen.
What do you think happened in those 2 days? What do you think he just sat around? Oh yeah, come to me. He was sitting there preaching to them too. Now he's no longer just, he's doing it all, man. He's getting, reaping it in. There's the lady. She's been gathering up the sheaves, man, and bringing them in. And now the other part is that the fields are white. He said, the Savior of the world. It just didn't say of the Jews. You know, Jesus Christ always looks so differently than we look. He says to his disciples, he says, hey, look, don't go. First, we got to concentrate with Israel. You know why he did that? People don't realize why he did that. He gets the apostles, and he says in Matthew chapter 10, he says, don't go the way of the Gentiles. He says, don't go to the Samaria. Don't go to these areas. He goes to the lost house of Israel. So everybody says, that's it. That's all there is to it. That was his whole total mission. I understand. If you want to go that way, what's he doing in Samaria? The other piece of that is, you want to know the reason he told them? I'm going to give it to you, why he told them to go to the lost house of Israel first. He wanted to use Israel as the vehicle to bring the world to Christ. And when they rejected, he went and got another vehicle. What was that? The church. The people you are today, a holy nation. It's not about countries, nations, nativity, born of, peoples, nations, are peoples. That's what that Bible's talking about when it says nations. It's peoples, natio, born of. People don't pick up on that. He's not worried about the country, he's worried about people. He's a people person. That Bible goes to chapter 11 of Genesis. Half of the time it took to write the Bible is over. At that point. If you figure John wrote all the way up to 96 AD, it's over. Half of the time is over chronological at Genesis chapter 11. When the Tower of Babel. From that point on, God does what? He starts dealing with people. Because he's a people person. God's worried about people. He turns around, he says, I'm reaping, and I sent you guys to reap where you didn't sow. Those prophets, and it's all been building up and building up and building up, and now all of a sudden he says, get out there and go get them. And that's what he's saying. Go out there and go get them. Now you're in the church. Look, you're reaping where other people have sown. You don't believe that everybody out there hasn't heard it? I haven't met a person in the United States that hasn't heard it. I haven't met anybody in the world yet that hasn't heard it, really. I haven't. I went over to the Middle East and I spoke to them. They all knew who Jesus was. Whether they're rejecting or not, they all knew him. It's been preached to the end of the earth. What are you doing today? We're just reaping. We're reaping where we haven't sown. It doesn't take much to just say, hey, man, I go to this church. He preaches the gospel. Come on down. Well, my preacher preaches the gospel. Does he? Does your preacher preach the gospel? Yes, he does. What is it? Can you tell me? And when they can't tell you, they, believe me, they start to think, what's the gospel? Well, I don't know. You must not be being preached to it. Either that or you're not listening. I've heard people tell me, this is exactly how they tell me in the town. I said, are you a Christian? They said, yes, I am. I say, if you're born again? And they say, no, I'm not. And the first thing out of my mouth is, you've been deceived. You can't be a Christian unless you're born again. Why? The Bible says, except a man be born again, a mankind, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Somebody has taught you wrong. It gives no door open. Look, when people get you past the first thing, hi, my name's Kirk. I come from Bible Baptist Church. And you have a church you go to. If they'll let me through the door at that point and keep me talking to them, it's pretty much I'm going to get the gospel to them. Ask anybody that's been with me. Look, there are people still out there that are listening. The fields are white. All around here, the fields are white. I walk the street. There's only 7 people usually on the streets here every afternoon. 7 people I can get tracts out to. That's all I get out. But there's 7 people. The fields are still white. Governor is white. People need to still get to be saved. And you know he's a savior of a whole world. And it says in verse number 43, it says, now after 2 days he departed thence and went into Galilee. For Jesus himself testified that a prophet had no honor in his own country. I bet you he just wanted to stay there and reap for a little while. But he said, what? I'm going to go back up there into my own area and still preach where I'm not even wanted. Jesus Christ, he says, I'm excited, man. People got saved. If God can be excited, hey, I'll give you this part. I'm going to give you a cookie right here. You remember in Luke, he says, there's rejoicing in heaven over one sinner that repenteth. There's rejoicing, he says, and one that comes to Christ too, he says. On one. Now, I want to ask you something. Did Christ die on the cross yet? No. He was the one talking. And he said there's rejoicing in front of the host of heaven. In front of the angels, he says. I'm sorry, in front of the angels, he says. Well, let me ask you something. If people ain't up there yet, and it's in front of the angels, who's the one that's rejoicing? It's God Almighty that's rejoicing. That's who's rejoicing, because he didn't die on the cross yet. They're still in the heart of the earth. Amen. Who's up there? Angels and God Almighty, and he's doing it in front of the angels. Who's rejoicing? God. Amen. The Lord is rejoicing on a sinner that just got saved, or a sinner that repenteth. You never thought about that, did you? God's got to be about the best rejoicer there is. Why? He wants you to do it. He's got to be a good example. And here's Jesus all excited that somebody got saved. Amen. Hey, I got to tell you guys, hey, we got food here. You know, you just need to understand this. My meat's to do the will of the Father. We need to get people saved around here. See, that's what Jesus is thinking. They're thinking about a meal, and he's thinking, hey, people need to get saved. He's excited about it. Did that change the way you read that? Yeah. That's good stuff, isn't it?
Amen.
Amen. Let's see people get saved. And that woman, she's reaping it right there. They're just coming in, and she's just reaping it. And he says both. That's why it says, he says both. He and verse 36, both he that soweth and he that reapeth may rejoice together. You know what they're receiving at the judgment seat of Christ? They're both receiving wages. Just bringing it on in. We sing the songs, man. It's good to be saved.
Amen.
It's good to be saved. Amen. Amen. All right, let's pray. Father, I thank you, Lord God, for this time. I thank you for the Lord. I thank you, Lord God, for that rejoicing. Lord Father, Jesus Christ being all excited about a soul getting saved, Lord God. Can we be that type of people, Lord, please, that you put it on our church, that we be excited when somebody gets saved? The Bible says Christ died for our sins. He was buried. He rose again the third day. The Bible says that for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. If you're here today and you're not saved, you need to get saved right now. You need to get into this. Except a man be born again. Are you born again? If you're not born again and you have that right now and you know it, you know it. You know if you're born again or you're not. I'm not talking about a false sense of security. It's hands, every head bowed, eyes closed. If you're sitting in here and you're saved today on your way to heaven, man, you know the Lord. But if you're not, you need to receive Christ. You need to receive Him as Savior. You need to take that payment for the pardon of your sin, for the payment on your sin, what He did on that cross and shed His blood for you. Would you receive Him today? I'm not out for your money. I'm not out for your work. I'm out for your soul. God wants to be excited today over one soul. Over one soul. Every day looking. Maybe that's you today. Maybe you'd say, that's me. I need to get saved. I'm not saved. I can feel it. I know it. I'm not saved. Maybe you'd get saved today. Receive Christ in your heart as your Savior. Lord, I'm a sinner. You're the Savior and I receive you. Maybe that's you today. You'd receive Christ today, trusting on Him, trusting on the blood He shed for the forgiveness of sin, having a relationship with Him, and then you're on your way to heaven. Don't worry about heaven first. Worry about having a relationship with Him, getting Him. Anybody? Anybody sit? Want to get saved? Anybody? How about you, Christian? You've been lacking when you're wanting to see people saved. Maybe you stop praying for them. There's people that just said they just can't get saved. Maybe you stop praying for them. Maybe you need to pray for them people. Maybe you need to ask the Lord, Lord, would you put people in my mind that I can pray for? The fields are white. Maybe you just don't have it to get out there and do it, but you should sure pray for somebody to be out there. He said, pray the Lord of the harvest that He'd send laborers out into His harvest. Maybe you'd pray for those who need to get out there. Right now, why don't you ask the Lord for laborers to go into His harvest. Please, pray for laborers in this harvest to go out there. Lord, I can't do it. Oh, well, you can pray for somebody to do it. You got family members unsaved? What would you pray for? Pray that God will send a laborer. God, would you send a laborer to my family? Please, Lord. Please, Lord, would you send a laborer to my family? Father, I thank you for this preaching. I thank you for the Word of God. I thank you, Lord, for being excited and being an example that we need to be, Lord. Love you, Lord. And tonight we're going to talk about David again and conquering of David and how David wanted to show kindness. We love you, Lord, and want to serve you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. That's what you say.